Yeah.
It's a big issue, so we get that every 4 years. So we want to continue to pray for those that were born on the 29th, but they only first get married 4 years. So continue to lift those up in prayer. Again, this is kind of preaching to the choir, but again, I think the word of God is repetitious. It's just like a beaten path. You go over and over and over because the Bible helps you to grow as you study the word of God. Amen? So this morning we're going to be looking at, again, I normally preach these messages at funerals, but again, it's a good time to talk about the Lord and talk about the things that he's done in our lives. So grab your Bibles and turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 5. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. We're going to be looking at the house that we have, that we live in. We've also been looking at the house that we're going to be going to once we go on to meet the Lord. So 2 Corinthians chapter 5, if you grab your Bibles, grab your phone, your notebook, your tablet, your iPad, or whatever you have, you turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 5. This probably won't be a long message, but again, hopefully we'll be able to get the points in to share with you how we need to be living a life to bring honor and glory to the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
I always say this every Sunday, and I continue to say it, I believe this is the inspired, inerrant, infallible word of God. I believe we have the best translation. I teach from the King James. A lot of people want the New King James. I teach from the King James. I know it has these and thous in it. But it was translated from Hebrew, Greek. It was translated from English and Aramaic to English language. So I'm grateful that we have what I call a roadmap. We have, again, a blueprint God left us for the Word of God. Amen?
Amen.
And I always say this, again, I know we talk about this election year, but I say this all the time. The pulpit should not be about politics. The pulpit is about the Word of God. So I don't preach politics. I don't preach philosophy. I don't preach human secularism. The only thing I preach is thus said the Lord. Amen, somebody. Now, you ought to vote because people died for the right to vote, and we live in a democracy. It's really a republic, and you ought to vote for your candidate. But I want you to realize this, that God exalts and he abases. So, amen. So we just need to do our part and leave the results to the Lord.
Amen,
amen, somebody.
Amen.
I was listening to a preacher on the radio. He's talking about, this is going to be one of the hardest time of election this year. We got two men, and I said, look, it's not going to be no different from any other time. We're just going to vote, and whoever the president, we're going to still pray for them, because the Bible told us to pray for those that are in office. Amen.
Amen.
Pray for those that are over you. Amen.
Amen.
We need to pray for the mayor. We need to pray for the governor. We need to pray for the congressman. We need to pray for the president. So we, as Christians, I'm not here to overthrow the government. I'm not here to go against a cue or cool. I'm here to pray that God will give them the wisdom and that he will use this government for the time. Amen?
Amen.
2 Corinthians chapter 5. When you get that, say amen.
Amen.
A lot of times, again, I just share with y'all, I preach at a lot of a fundamental Baptist church. A lot of times they have to stand for the word of God. Now, again, it's just giving reference to the word of God. So there's nothing wrong with standing or not. But you don't have to stand. It's just an issue that they like to sometimes give reference to the word of God. We're going to look at 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 1. It says, for we know that if our what? Earthly house of this tabernacle was dissolved, that's the body, we have a building of God and house what? Not made with hands, eternal into heaven. For in this we groan earnestly, desiring to be clothed upon with our house, which is what?
From heaven.
From heaven. If so be that being clothed, we shall not be found naked. think they call it Black History Month, February. But we're going to call it the day that we praise the Lord and give you honor and glory. Thank you for everyone that's listening to the sound of my voice, those that are here today, those that are watching by Facebook, or those that may be on a bed of affliction. We pray, Lord, that you would use the word to speak to their hearts today, Lord. We always lift up, Lord, the COVID various situation, Lord, those are still battling. I just talked to a guy a week ago. He came down with COVID. We thought COVID was gone, but people are still getting various with COVID, Lord, are still getting some of the things that affect them, and they have to isolate for 5 days, Lord. So we're praying, Lord, that you would intervene with the people that are dealing with COVID. Praying for the first-line responders. I already mentioned them, the nurses, the doctors, the firemen, the policemen, the medics, all those to help us navigate, Lord, through this COVID. Pharmaceutical workers, Lord, praying for all those that help us, those that may be in the hospital and ICU. Matter of fact, we had one of our church members' daughter in ICU, Lord. So we pray, Lord, that you would intervene and work that situation out. They may be, some may be on ventilators, Lord, and may be on life support, Lord. You know, Lord. So we pray that you would raise them up, Lord, and give them back to us, Lord. We pray for, again, our schools, Lord. We got our young people that are in school, and some of them are playing sports. We pray that they be healthy, Lord. Again, I said earlier that some of them are playing basketball and they're getting ready to go into the district, getting ready to go to the state tournament, Lord. I was supposed to be going to Cooper to the state tournament, Lord. So we pray, Lord, that you would give them strength and help, Lord, to keep them from harm, danger, from hurting their body. But most of all, we pray that they would realize that the gift that you've given them, whether it's basketball, football, track, or baseball, whatever it is from the Lord. And they need to realize that they need to give the Lord the honor and the glory and the praise. We're praying for our schools, Lord. Again, we're praying for superintendent, praying for the principal, praying for the teachers, praying for the resource officers, the bus drivers, Lord, the cafeteria, praying for the students, Lord. Praying that you would keep them safe, Lord, and they would be able to ascertain the correct information and go to the next level, Lord. In May, we'll be having graduation. I heard people talk about this as a graduation a month in May. So we're praying, Lord, that those who will be graduating and would get the ACT and SAT grades together so they can go on trade school or college or military or whatever you call them. We're praying for what's going on in Ukraine, what's going on in Israel, Lord. We know there's a war going on with Hamas and Israel. There's a war going on with Russia and Ukraine. So, Lord, we know that you said there'll be war and rumors of war. So, Lord, we pray that you would intervene and work that situation out, Lord. I'm not over in Israel, Lord. I don't know when Nathan Tyler should be making decisions. But you know, Lord. So I'm praying that we as Americans, Lord, that we would be an ally to the people that are suffering, especially you say pray for the peace of Israel. So I'm praying that we would do what you call it. That you would give again commander-in-chief wisdom and knowledge of how to deal with the situation in Israel, how to deal with the situation with Saudi Arabia and Syria and Lebanon and Jordan and all those Arab nations that are around Israel. Then we're praying for our military, praying for our missionaries, praying for every church planted by your right. Now, Lord, I pray you forgive me of my sin. Help me to rightly divide the word of truth. Use me just for a little while on this fourth Sunday to preach and teach the honor of the faith of God. And we'll be careful to give you all the honor and the praise. For the mighty name of Jesus. And everybody say amen.
Amen.
Everybody needs three homes. I don't care who you are. You need an earthly home. And that earthly home is your body. Your body, if you've never heard it before, has a spirit and a soul. They live in this body. When God created Adam, he breathed into his nostrils, he became a living soul. But this body won't be him forever. daddy not doing his job. And it broke my heart. I said, we need to get back to a Christian home. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
We need to get back to a man doing what he needs to do. And I heard a guy, he put on Facebook, said, well, you know, we need to get black men back in the home. Well, let me just say, and I'm not going to be hard, there are some black men that are in home taking care of their children. So don't get hard on all black men. All black men are not bombed. All black men are not deadbeat dads. There are some black men that are raising their children and that are there with their children and bringing honor, going to church with their children. So let's not get hard on all black men. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Christian home. This has to do with the home and the family. Now, I'm not talking about a home of drama. A home is a place that ought to be where you come and get some peace and quiet. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
You know how you want to go home. You always want to go home for peace. You leave your job, you want to go to a home. You want to go to a place where you can lay down and rest. You don't want to go to a place where you be fussing and fighting. You want to go to a place where there's always some drama. You don't want to go to a place where the kids don't want to obey you. You want to go to a home that brings honor and glory to the Lord. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
And it needs to be a Christian home, a peaceful home, without drama. You hear this all the time. That's a drama queen. That's a drama king. That's a drama child. That's a drama teenager. That's a drama person. They always got some issues. Let me tell you, we need a home that brings honor and glory to the Lord.
Amen.
If we line up with the scripture, if we line up with doing what's right, we have a peaceful home.
Amen.
Y'all get a little weak over now. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Second Kings, I told you about Hezekiah. The Lord told him, says, just set your house in order or you're going to die. When the Lord has said, set your house in order, he said, you need to get things straight. Right? You need to do things to bring honor and glory to the Lord. Let me tell you, everything that happened, you need to take it to the Lord. I don't care how small the problem is. I don't care how many issues you got on. I don't care if you have a marital problem. I don't care if you have a children problem. You need to take it to the Lord and leave it there. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
God is able to do. Everybody wants a happy, peaceful home. Whether you're single, you want a single, or single parent, or married with children, or empty nest, you want a home. And I've heard this so many times, and I don't know where it comes from, but I'm going to preach against it. These men, they get what they call the midlife crisis. And then all of a sudden the children go leave the home. And then they don't want to be the wife no more. And then they want to get a young, sweet thing like Michael Jackson say, you pretty little thing. Let me tell you, that's from the devil.
Amen.
You stay with that wife of your youth. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
You stay with her the whole time. Yeah, she might be getting some wrinkles, but you are too. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
She may be getting a little old and having to, y'all don't get me on this, having to, piece, a little piece of the hair, but the men, you going bald, you got all and the muscles, you can have them drop down. So you need to stay with your wife, just like y'all was young together, you need to grow up together. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Family circle of love is more precious than money.
Amen.
Let me preach a little bit. And I hate to be preaching on these entertainers and so forth. But all of them got all the money in the world. But their family life is messed up. They'd have been married four or five times. Somebody would tell me about, and I hate to say these girls, but y'all know who they are. They done had four or five husbands, got four or five kids, and now they dating somebody else. And then they back on their Facebook again, and then they date somebody else, and then they had an NBA game, and they with somebody else. Let me tell you, that's a mess. They got all that money, but the family life is messed up. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
If you never heard it, let me give it to you. It's in Ephesians. Husband, love your wife as Christ loved the church.
Amen.
Even if she don't do what you say.
Amen.
Oh, that's a hard one. But she don't do what I say. She ain't got to do what you say. She just love anyway.
Amen.
You love your wife. And let me just say that. I hate to be hard on you Afro-American black women, but y'all have strong will.
Amen.
Let me preach a little bit. They ain't going to tell me what to do. They ain't my daddy. Hold on a minute. The Bible says, the Bible says you need to let him be the leader.
Amen.
Now, I understand he may not be as educated as you. He may not be as smart as you. But your job is just to help him. You are on his team. You're not competing with him. You are supposed to be his helpmate. Let me picture a little bit. God put Adam to sleep, and he took a rib, and he formed a woman. He called her Eve, and he brought her to Adam. He said, here's your helpmate. She to help you, Adam. She's not to tear you down, and you're not to tear her down, and she to help you. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Singles, looking for a mate, wait on the Lord. I was talking about that Sunday night. This girl was going to Tennessee. dating. I said, you're not dating? She said, no, because the guys that I want to date, they don't want to support me in my calling to go to DePaul as a missionary. She said, if I start dating them guys, they're going to pull me from my calling. So she said, I just gave up dating. So she didn't have a clue that she'd ever, now she wanted to be married, and she wanted to have children, but she didn't want to risk it dating some guy who didn't have the same vision. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
So guess what? She goes on deportation, goes all the way to Nepal, out there winning people to the Lord. People are in Hinduism, people in Buddhism, winning to the Lord. And just so happened there's another American out there who happened to be out there doing the same thing, and God put them together. And she sent me a postcard saying, I'm getting married.
Amen.
I went all the way to DePaul to get my husband. But he had the same vision that I have. He wanted to win people to the Lord. He's out here doing the same work. And I could have messed up my life if I'd have dated some old crude guy over here in America who didn't want to do right. So I just waited on the Lord. And now let me tell you, single, if you need a mate, wait on the Lord.
Amen.
Amen, somebody. He'll bring you a mate in a new town. Home is a place where when it's cold outside, you want to be able to go and get some heat.
Mm-hmm.
Amen, somebody.
Amen.
It blows my mind the amount of homeless people out there. I mean, it blows my mind. I mean, it didn't used to be that much right here in Hickson. But I can go down the street and see somebody sleeping in a tent. I'm thinking, how in the world are you going to be warm in a tent? You need a home where you can go home and get cozy and get under the blanket and cut on the heat and get a pillow and get some warmth. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
You need a home like that.
Amen.
And then when COVID hit, nobody, there's no place like home. Well, you couldn't go nowhere. Y'all remember that?
Mm-hmm.
That's what happened. And I hate to say this, and y'all don't get on me, but all these teenagers started getting mental distress because they couldn't go nowhere. They just couldn't hide like being at home. I can't go nowhere. They closed down the school. They closed down the mall. And they closed down the theater. And I'm just sick of being home. And it got pitiful. They should have been able to have joy at home. Home was the place you ought to have joy. Now, you need to put down that game. And you need to put down that phone. You need to learn how to have some fun. Sometimes you need to go back to reading. Sometimes you need to go back to going outside and playing. But you need to have joy at home. Amen, somebody. We live in a society today where it's technological. Nobody talk to nobody. Everybody on their phone. Everybody on their computer. Everybody on their iPad. Let me tell you, we've lost communication. We need to get back to having closeness with people. We need to get back to talking to people. We need to get back to reading with people. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
We need to get back to that. When it's snow outside and you can't go nowhere, you can be at home. Amen, somebody. Most of y'all can deal with this. When the power go out, you ain't got no power, but you can be at home. I remember one time our power went out, and we ain't had no power, but I had a fireplace. Oh, let me preach a little bit. I had some logs there. I went and got some logs throwed on the heat, on the fireplace, and we had some heat. I said, well, we ain't got no light. Then we got some camera. Y'all be preaching a little bit, because I'm at home. And look, I'm happy. I ain't got no electricity, but I got some heat. I got some light. So I had a joy being home. So we need to learn how to have a home that brings honor and glory to the Lord. Amen, somebody. When you're tired and sick, no place like home. When you're having a Thanksgiving and a Christmas, and Grandma used to cook all them fixings, and you just go around and no place like home. Y'all remember the day, right? We need to get back to that. Thanksgiving, we going to Grandma, and she going to lay it out, and we going to be potato salad and coleslaw and baked beans and pork chop and chicken and steak, and we going to have a good time. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
You need to get back to home. Y'all been preaching a little bit?
Yeah.
We don't even cook no more at home. Everybody eating McDonald's and Burger King. Come on, somebody.
Amen.
What we going to eat? the second thing, that was my first point. We need a Christian home with no drama. The second home that you need a church home with no drama. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Don't you hear me now? 20 million millennials have fell away from church. 20 million millennials and Gen Z, born in 1980s on up, they don't go to church no more. And it's sad because we're living in a day where they don't think church is important. Let me tell you, you need a church home. A church is a hospital. A church is a home where you can fellowship. I've been preaching to the ladies, the older ladies ought to train the young women. The older men ought to train the young men. We need to get back to church.
Amen.
Amen, somebody. Basic steps in church. David said like this in Psalm 84:10, I'd rather be a doorkeeper in the house of the Lord than to dwell in the tents of the wicked. What he's saying is I'd rather go to church than be out here in the gang banging. I'd rather go to church than be out here with my homies smoking weed. I'd rather go to church than to be out there running with the girl. Look, I need to be in church. Amen,
amen,
somebody.
Amen.
To get back to church. And then the church needs to be a place you're not going to like this one, where you get some good preaching. You need to step on your toe. You don't need no church.
Well, you know, God loves you.
And God is going to, let me tell you, God loves you, but God hates sin.
Amen.
God loves you, but God wants you to live a holy life. So you might get mad at me, but I'm going to tell you, shagging is of the devil. I'm going to tell you, you need to get married. I'm going to tell you, God is against same-sex marriage. I'm going to tell you, you might not want me to preach it, but I'm going to preach what the Bible says. God hates abortion. It's killing. I'm going to preach what God said the Lord. Man, your church ain't gonna be full. Big deal, ain't my church, it's God's church. God told me to preach the word of God. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Preach good preaching. Paul told Timothy, preach the word. Be instant in season, out of season. When they want to hear, when they don't want to hear. Preach the word, because it'll raise people up. We need to get back to preaching the word of God. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Like my grandma used to give me castor oil. Y'all remember the day when castor oil was get anything. Grandma would take care of you. Boy, you sick? Get on in here. Drink some of that castle. That'd be the nasty man to get sick. But it'll knock whatever was in and knock it on out to her. You go to the restroom, you be clean. You say, oh, I feel good now. I done got all that junk out of me. I remember a time, y'all might not remember, because I'm going back, I'm telling my age there, when you got the mumps, and she take them sardines, younger them sardines, and she tie it around, and you be going around with sardine neck on you. Grandma took care of you. But guess what? That's what you need. You need somebody to take care of you. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Sunday morning, we need to look forward to coming to the house of the Lord. We need to look forward to coming to the church where you have not only have good preaching, but you have people that pray for you.
Wow.
You need somebody to pray for you. Now, look, it's okay to pray by yourself, but there's nothing like corporate prayer. When you come together, and every fourth Wednesday, I remember the lady when we had COVID, and we couldn't really come to church, and they came and they started a messenger prayer online. Y'all remember that? And I'm so glad, but a lot of people say, well, you know, the internet is the devil. You know, Facebook is the devil. Let me tell you, use it for the Lord.
Amen.
Look, we use Messenger to pray together. We use Facebook to give the word of God. So stop saying that the internet and all that's for the devil. Use it for the God.
Amen.
So then pray it on the phone. Pray it on it. I went all the way again. Y'all remember I went all the way to Florida. They had a tornado. And I was down in the tent, and a preacher came all the way from the island. He said, I listened to Brother Jesus on Facebook. I've been listening to the sermon. I said, thank you, Lord, that the message is going out. Amen, somebody. So don't be hard on Facebook. Don't be hard on Twitter, because we can use it for the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Matthew 6:6, say, enter into your closet and pray. And your Father who sees things secretly will reward you openly. Let me tell you, I can't explain to you all the blessing that God did for you. It will blow your mind. So sometimes God bless you, and you can't even tell people about it because they wouldn't believe it. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
God answers prayers in the midnight hour. God answers prayers when you're burdened down. God has a prayer. I can just preach a little bit, and I'm going to just preach just a little bit. I remember when Tatum was in the hospital, and I remember when he was having a problem, and we began to pray. And God answers the prayer. Let me tell you, God answers the prayer that you came with. And sometimes the doctors came, and Wayne was giving his testimony. And he said his kidney was like 100 and something. And they said, we got problems. And then they kept taking, they kept testing. They kept putting them on the IV. And then the next thing, it was below 0.3 something. He said, look, God, showed up. Maybe it's somebody.
Amen.
I ain't got time to tell you. He's an awesome God. I'm going to be preaching on the radio. I'm going to tell you about it. He's awesome. Mm. He's omnipotent. He's all power. He's omniscient. He knows everything. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
You need people like that to pray for you. Luke 18:1 says, men ought to always pray and not to faint. Pray and men don't faint. And faint men don't pray.
Amen.
You know, a lot of people say, well, you know, I don't believe in God. I'm an atheist. Well, hold on a minute. Get out there in the foxhole with some of the bullet come across. A lot of times, those military guys in the military, when that bullet cross their head, they begin to pray out the Lord. Lord, would you just spare my life? Now, you call on God when you're in trouble. Let me tell you, you need to call on when you're good time.
Amen.
Call on when you ain't got no money. Call on when you got money. When your bankroll is full, call on the Lord. When you're healthy, call on the Lord. When you're sick, call on the Lord. Amen. When you ain't got no problem, call on the Lord. When you got problems, call on the Lord. You need to call on him anytime because he's a present help in the time of need. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
We need to call on the Lord. We need to pray for him. Here it is, tender-hearted, kind church.
Oh.
You know, we done lost the word kind in the church. Everybody got a haughty attitude. You don't need to be mean in church. You ought to love people. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
You ought to get along with people. Well, she sung my song. You ain't got no song. You need to come to church. And she said in my seat, you ain't got no seat.
Amen.
You need to have loving heart. Amen. 1 Corinthians 12 says, God set members in the body as it pleased him. God said, take the same care for those in the church. Let me tell you, everybody in the church is important. Whether you're the pastor or you're just in the nursery, you're important. God sent you here because you like I preach it all the time, you like a body. The body needs each other. Like the fingers need the hand, and the hand needs the arm. And the elbow needs the shoulder, and the shoulder needs the neck, and the neck needs the head. We're all connected. One of them can't do without the other one. Amen, somebody. If I have an itch at night, I have to take my arm and scratch my back. If I didn't have no finger or no finger, I wouldn't be able to scratch. Let me tell you, everything is important.
Amen.
Amen, somebody. James said it like this. A little, and you'll save a brother from his error. Love comes a multitude of sin. He said, now if somebody come in your assembly and got a gold ring on you, you set them up high. But then somebody come in your assembly that's got on ragged clothes, you set them in the back. He said, no, that's wrong. You shouldn't have no partiality in the church. Should be no favoritism in the church. Everybody we just talked about in Sunday school is at the cross on the ground level. Amen, somebody. I don't care if you got a PhD. I don't care if you got a JD. I don't care if you got a BS. You're still the same for a guy who just got a GED, who just graduated from high school, who may not finish high school. You're on the same level when it comes to Christ because we're all equal in Christ.
Amen.
Amen.
You know what you need is a BA, born again.
Amen.
I'm not worried about my accolades. All I need to know is I've been born from above. Jesus told Nicodemus, said, Nicodemus, you must be born again. Nicodemus was like some of you say, how can a man be born when he's old? How can an old man enter the second time in his mother's womb? You know, he was trying to use that natural. You know, when a woman have a baby and the water break and she dilates and the baby come out, he was trying to say, I'm old. I can't be born again. Nicodemus, and Jesus looked past him and he said, I ain't talking about a natural birth. I'm talking about born of the Spirit and of the water. I'm talking to be born from above. I'm talking to give your life to Jesus Christ. And I don't know what he's going on, but Nicodemus got saved.
Amen.
Me and Jerry were talking about that. Jerry said, he was 50 when he got saved. It don't matter as long as I'm saved. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
I got saved. It don't matter. You know, they try to bring my whole life. Well, I remember you. I don't care what you remember. That brother you used to know, he's dead now. I'm a new creature in Christ. And people try to always, well, you know what you used to do. I don't care what I used to do. I ain't that same person no more. So I don't want to hear it. That person is dead. You're talking to a new person in Christ. I don't know who you're talking about. Yes, I might have been in the past, but I've been washed in the blood. Cleaned up. Maybe somebody.
Amen.
You got to have a church home that brings honor and glory where we don't show an impartiality in the church. We got to have a church home where we can come together and work together. We've been talking about how we need to work together. We need Sunday school teachers to work with the youth. We've been burdened down about our youth. Well, they need to come to church. Our youth cannot learn anything if they're not in church. They need to come to Vacation Bible School. They cannot learn. Well, if I bring Charlotte head to town when we was doing the altar to Halloween, she had some questions, and she was asking, who built the ark? If they don't been to Sunday school, they won't know no built the ark.
Right.
They need to be But the first child came. You need to know the Bible. Children will not know the Bible if they don't come to church and be taught the Word of God. Amen, amen somebody.
Amen.
And let me just shake it down a little further. It ought to be taught in your home.
Amen.
They shouldn't be having to come to church to learn something about the Bible. Well, I don't know. I remember one time I was asking a question. I said, well, who delivered the children out of Egypt? And all them youth were looking around. I said, everybody know who that was. He told Pharaoh to let my people, you don't know who that was? They were young people, teenagers, that didn't know Moses. Let me tell you, they need to be in Bible quizzes. They need to be in Bible camp. They need to be in Sunday school. They need to be in vacation Bible school where they can learn the Word of God. I remember when my daughters were growing up, they would win every year. We'd have trophies. We'd give out for Bible memorization, for Bible quizzes, for questioning the Bible. And they would take the trophies home every year, and they would say, well, Jesus, y'all, I'm having it because your daughter's winning. I said, they winning because I teach them the Word of God. That's why they winning.
Amen.
You need to teach your children the Word of God.
Amen.
Get upset with me because you don't know. That you need to teach them. They ain't going to learn it by themselves.
Amen,
amen somebody.
Amen.
I remember, I just gave my testimony. I was 30 years old, and my little brother, Felix, I call his name, my grandmama sent me a picture of him on his knees praying. And he was in Chicago, Illinois, and she sent me a picture. She said, your brother sent his prayers. And I was 30 years old and had not remembered the Lord's prayer. And the Holy Spirit convicted me right there. You can't even pray the Lord's prayer. You're a grown man. Church home without cliques and favoritism and nepotism, and you need a heavenly home built by Jesus Christ. Point number one, do you have a Christian home that you can go home and get some peace? Do you have a Christian home where you can go and lift your head at night? I don't know why I should say this, but I don't normally watch TV. I'm not a TV person, but I was studying, and I was looking at some basketball game, and the game went off, and then forensic science came on, forensic mystery. And it blew my mind that all these people killing people in their own home. These wives was killing their husband and signing a $400,000 life insurance and then plotting it like he killed himself. And I said, the home ought to not be like that. But you can't, and he was scared writing his daughters and saying, you know, I think my wife is planning to kill me. And I think she took out $500,000 life insurance. That's pitiful. And then you got, let me preach it, children killing their parents. God, let y'all know what I'm talking about. What happened to the home? What happened to the love in the home? What happened to children loving their mom and their dad? And I already preached on the sexual connotation in the home. Dad is having a relationship with their stepdaughter. Dad is having a relationship with their biological. Dad is messing up. And then what messed me up is they have dad have a relationship with boys, with their own son.
Yep.
It's beautiful. We need to get back to the Word of God.
Amen.
Well, the reason he's gay, he was abused. What? When he was a child. What? By somebody he trusted in. What? You mean somebody, his uncle, abused him? And so he don't know any better. Say it! Y'all know what I'm talking about.
Amen.
is running rampant. Sin is on, like I say, is running rampant in America.
Yeah.
It's going crazy. We got sexual perversion. We got sexual sin. We got all this mess going on. And what I can't stand is when the movie portrays, even now, they got girls kissing girls in the womb. I can't stand it in the commercial. It used to be, well, you see a commercial, it'd be a man and a woman. Now they got a woman and a woman and a man and a man. And they think he's going to accept that. I do not accept that garbage. Commercials are messed up. All the stuff on TV messed up. Oh, let me preach a little bit. You want me to preach on this one? Disney is messed up. Disney's got homosexual characters in cartoons. Y'all ain't like you know what I'm talking about. They teach it. They're trying to hear them get in the mind of children when they're kindergarten. They're teaching these cartoon characters are gay. Let me just put this in here. You know what I'm talking about. In the movie Lion King. What was the guy named? The little muskrat, Taylor Potato, whatever his name was. He was gay. The little muskrat that used to sing. He was gay in the Lion King movie. Now, what in the world are you doing with a gay character in a cartoon character?
Amen.
Messing up our children. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Need to help the church home. And then the last one. Everybody need a heavenly home built by Jesus Christ.
Amen,
amen somebody. Your eternal destiny falls where you're going to live. I don't care who you are. You're going to die one day. And you need to know without a shadow of a doubt that you're going to heaven. Not what people say, well, I'm going to go to heaven if I think I'm going to heaven. No, you need to know without a shadow of a doubt. You know that you know that you're going to heaven. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
There's a heaven and there's a hell. There's a real heaven. I know the Jehovah's Witnesses and everybody don't believe in a heaven. And I know the Muslims don't believe in a heaven. But let me tell you, there's a real heaven. Just like Chattanooga is a real place. Just like Atlanta is a real place. Just like Montgomery, Alabama is a real place. Just like New York is a real place. Just like Chicago is a real place. Heaven is a real place.
Amen.
The streets of gold. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
You need to know that you're going to heaven. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
The Bible says, Jesus said, if I go away, I will come again. And he said, I go to prepare a place for you. And there where I am, there you may be also. And he'd been gone 2,000 years. And he's preparing a place for me. And when he come again, he's going to call me unto himself. He's building a mansion for me in heaven. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
You didn't know where you're going. I don't want to be nobody that died and don't know where I'm going.
Oh.
And every now and then I get a call from the funeral home. And they ask me to preach somebody's funeral. Now, I'll preach anybody's funeral. But I always ask this question, what are they saying? And the first thing they said, well, we don't know. I said, well, then I can't put them in heaven. I'm going to just say, this person didn't already sign their warrant where they're going. But you out there are hitting the funeral. Let me talk to you. You need to make sure that you're going to heaven when you die. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Heaven is real. But you got to be saved. Salvation is necessary to get to heaven.
Mm-hmm.
Ecclesiastes 3:11 says he has put the world in a void in your heart. Let me tell you, even the heathen in the bush in Africa is seeking a God. There's something in them that they need to know who Jesus is. And the only way they get it, they have to yearn for the Holy Spirit. And if they yearn hard enough, God will send a missionary. The missionary will go all in the jungle and out the bush and will tell them about Jesus Christ and they will get saved. I remember one time this guy went all the way to the Philippines and he talked to people about saved. And they'd say, where have you been all my life? I've been waiting for somebody to tell me about this Jesus. I'm so glad that you finally came to our country and told us about Jesus. Start crying. Matter of fact, in Papua New Guinea, they brought Bibles in on airplane, and the whole community came out, and they was cheering, and they was shouting, we're getting the Bible, we're getting the Bible. They're so excited. The Word of God, let me preach a little bit. America, you got Bibles in the hotel room. America, you got Bibles in prison. America, you got Bibles in your house, in 3 or 4 rooms, and you never open it up.
Amen.
You need to get back to the Bible. By the way, the Bible has to be read.
Amen.
It ain't gonna go in your mind by osmosis.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I went to sleep. No. Go to sleep, won't get it. If you're like kids, you tell me, say, preacher, pray for me. I got a math test. I said, okay, did you study? No. Well, I'm gonna pray you get an F there. You ain't studied. God ain't gonna bring nothing back to your memory. Don't think God gonna give you the knowledge when you ain't studied. I tell my grandkids, you need to study. You need to prepare yourself. God ain't gonna bring no back to you if you didn't study. Go in the classroom, you're going to make a big fat F. You're going 6 say, now is acceptable time. You don't need to wait. Some people say, well, you know, I can't get saved because I got all this stuff going on in my life. Let me tell you, you don't know when you're going to die. Well, you know, because I'm young, I still got some wild oats to sow. Look, you ain't got no wild oats to sow. You need to get to the Lord today. You need to come by the blood is running deep in your veins. Let me tell you, now is the day of salvation. You can go right out here and cross the street and a transfer truck, an 18-wheeler run over you and kill you. You need to get saved today.
Amen.
While the word is drawing you, while the Holy Spirit is working on your heart, while you're under conviction, while you're listening to the word of God, you need to say, preacher, like the Bible said, they ran to Paul and Philip jail and said, sir, what must I do to be saved? And Paul said, believe on the name of Lord Jesus, and thou shalt be saved in thy whole house. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
You're saved today. 2 Corinthians 5 says, therefore, if any man named Christ, he's a what?
You're a Christian.
All things are passed away. What you saying, preacher? Let me help you out. Before I got saved, my hand used to be in the wrong place. The stuff I used to handle. And you say what you used to handle. I ain't going to tell you what I used to handle. But I had to get rid of that old stuff and start handling the Bible. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
The stuff I used to drink. I had to stop drinking all that mess and get back with the Lord. Well, my feet used to take me. My feet used to take me, let me just say, clubs and places I ain't used to be. And I heard them talk about in Atlanta. They said, oh, we need to bring the freaknik back to Atlanta. You don't need to bring no freaknik back to Atlanta. You need to get back with the Lord.
Amen.
Amen, somebody. Romans 10:13 says, for faith come by hearing what?
Hearing
by the word of God. You're not going to get saved by nothing but this book, the word of God. You're not going to get saved by a song. You're not going to get saved by a dream. You're not going to be saved by something hit you in the head. You're going to get saved by the word of God. As you hear the word of God, you receive it, then God will save your wretched soul. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
And then you need to walk with the Lord.
Amen.
What you saying, preacher? Every day you need to say, Lord, guide my footsteps. There's a light into my path, a lamp to. Every day I need to ask the Lord to help me. I told y'all about it. I'm going to be going on the radio. I'm going there tomorrow to start recording. Let me tell you, I'm already praying. Lord, guide my tongue. Guide my footsteps. Help me to say the right thing to somebody on the ways out there may hear the gospel. Look, I don't know who gets saved, but one day when I get to heaven, somebody might say, Jesus, I heard you preach on the radio, and I bowed my head and received Lord Jesus Christ, and I'm in heaven because of you, and I'm going to say hallelujah. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Billy Graham preached to thousands, and people got saved. He don't know everybody got saved, but one day when he get to heaven, all these people say, I came to the crusade, I heard the message, and I got saved. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
We must have walked with the Lord. Here it is, in the home, in the church, and in society. Now, what gives me is that we can live for the Lord on Sunday, then live for the devil on Monday.
Mm-hmm.
Come on now. Mm-hmm. If you're going to live one way, stay that way. Be consistent. Don't come, like James said, in the house of the Lord and praise the Lord, and then on Monday cuss your brother out. Don't do that. Don't come to the Lord and say, praise the Lord, and then disobey your parents on Monday. Don't do that. Don't come to the house and say, praise the Lord, and then you don't want to obey the teacher. Let me tell you, be obedient. Live a life that brings honor and glory to the Lord. I remember when I was teaching at the schools, and I would go in, and I would ask the people, I said, now, if I ask your classmates, are you a Christian, what would they say? You know your classmates know you're a Christian, huh? There was a 16-year-old girl. She was stopping her every time the gang get into a fight, she would stop it. Every time these girls want to fight, pull each other head out and claw each other with their fingernails, she stopped it. And so they had graduation. And she wasn't even in the 12th grade, she was in the 10th grade. And they said, the senior class wants to give a reward to this 16-year-old girl for having a Christian attitude and a Christian demeanor in the whole school. Everybody knew that she was the only one that could bring peace and harmony in any situation. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
She had a testimony. We need to have a testimony. 1 Thessalonians 4:13 says, you sorrow even as others sorrow. You're going to have some trials in this world, but don't give up. John 14:1, I said, Jesus said, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it's not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go, I will come again, and I will receive you unto myself. There where I am, there you may be also. Let me tell you, Jesus is coming back. Now, don't get caught up in everybody talking about Buddha and Muhammad and Confucius and all these folks. Let me tell you, their bones are rotting in the grave.
Amen.
Well, come Easter Sunday, which is the 31st of March, I'm going to be preaching on Jesus Christ. When they went to look for the bones, when they looked for the grave, they said, RV was him preaching. He said, look, this book is like the book of life. Mm. He said, one day God gonna open the book. He gonna look for your name. Mm-hmm. In heaven now. And he gonna look down the road and he gonna say, I don't see your name. Then he gonna close the book. Mm-hmm. It's gonna be too late then, folks. Oh. You're gonna be cast into a lake of fire with brimstone. Let me tell you, today, if you're not saved, write your name. Get God to write your name in the Lamb of the Lord. He'll write it in blood, with his blood. He'll take his fingers up, and write your name. Make sure you're saved. Make sure you have a heavenly home when you die. As I close today, I want to say, watch about Facebook. Make sure you got those three homes. Make sure you got a home, an earthly home that's peaceful, harmony. That you can go home, you know, fussing and fighting from your wife and the children. From the husband and your sister and brother, you can't get along. Get that straight. Get all that strife out of your home. Make sure you have a home that's peaceful and harmony. Then make sure you have a church home. A lot of you don't go to church. Let me tell you, especially you millennials, when you Gen Z, get into a Bible believing church. Get on your pastor. I tell people all the time, your pastor is on TV. He can't see you when you get sick. Go on to the weather room and call the pastor on TV to tell evangelists. He ain't gonna come see you. You need a pastor that can come see you when you're in the hospital. You need a pastor who can call you and talk to you personally. You need a pastor who can do your funeral when you die. You need a church home. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
And then last of all, you need a heavenly home. Mm-hmm. Now, don't go on this. I'm saved, preacher. Oh, my mom was a Christian. That ain't got nothing to do with you. Mm-hmm. I'm saved, preacher, because I've been baptized. That ain't got nothing to do with this thief on the cross. Wasn't baptized. He was there. You need to get saved by putting your faith and trust in the Lord. You say, well, how do you do that? Just like you trust in the brakes on your car when you're driving, mm-hmm. and you put your foot on the brakes and they stop. Even when I was on the interstate coming home, they were flying by me. 80, 90 miles. I'm saying, Lord have mercy. But they, when the brakes stop, they slow their car down. They trust in the brakes. Just like you trust in the brakes, you can trust in the brakes. Mm-hmm. Well, they need the sun's brakes or something like that. Dear Jesus. Realize that the preacher's talking about I need that heavenly home. I've never been saved. I've never gave my life to the Lord. I've never been a Christian to bring honey groceries. So, Lord, right now, I pray you forgive me my sin. Lord, I pray that you come into my heart and save me. Lord, I believe that Jesus died. I believe that he was buried. And I believe that he rose from the dead. Come into my heart today, Lord, and save me. And write my name in the Lamb of the Lord. Now, if you're a Christian and you fall away from the church, Christian gets so compromised and so callous out there, living like the devil, living like the world, you can come home. So you can face something like, Lord, I've not been living like I should be. I realize now that my life is right. I am good. Forgive me, Lord, where I fell down, and help me to get back on the fire and line and use my life.